Hi, this is Erkan. In this video, I will introduce you to the ASP.NET web pages. I will cover how to add a new page to a web application, how to add controls to a page, and how to write some simple server-side scripts for ASP.NET pages. Let's switch back to Visual Studio and get started. The pages that you create in ASP.NET web applications are called webform pages or just webforms. The reason why they are called webforms is because they are commonly used for building forms for data entry that needs to be posted back to the server for processing. However, of course, you can create ASP.NET webforms for displaying data. Let's go ahead and add a new webform to our web application. By the way, if you haven't done already, you should create an empty web application to be able to add a webform. To add a webform, I will first right-click on the project name in the Solution Explorer, and then I will choose Add, and then New Item, which will bring me this dialog. Please first make sure the web under Visual C# is selected, and then choose Webform from the middle section. Let's name our webform as default.aspx. ASP.NET webforms have the aspx filename extension. This extension causes the page to be processed by ASP.NET. If you somehow forget to add the aspx extension to the webform name, don't worry. Visual Studio will automatically add it for you. I will click Add button to create the webform. Now, actually I have several updates in the Visual Studio workspace. First, default.aspx is added to the project as you can see in the Solution Explorer. Second, default.aspx is automatically open in the editor in the middle of the workspace. And the last, toolbox is loaded with a bunch of web controls that I can use to build my web form. Under the editor, there are three secret modes that you can use, which are design, split, and source. By default, updated with source view. That is why we are seeing the HTML markup of the page. The design view shows approximately how the web form will look like when viewed in the browser. With split option, you can obtain the both views at the same time. Our web form looks like actually an HTML page, except this page directive at the top of the page. This page directive helps us do some settings for our web form. And as long as you don't need to do some advanced configurations, you don't need to change anything in page directives. One thing here that I want to further emphasize is this code behind attribute with value of default.aspx.cs. And if you expand the default.aspx in the Solution Explorer, you will see default.aspx.cs, which is the code behind file associated with our web form default.aspx. This code behind file is where you write the server-side code to build the application logic. Every ASP.NET page comes with its associated code behind file, and its naming convention follows like whatever your page name .aspx.cs. By the way, why we have CS extension is actually because we will write our code in C# language. So if you consider the ASPX file, the webform file, the body of your website, then the code behind file ASPX.cs file is the soul of the website since it contains the application logic that will define the behavior of your page. Actually, having the design and the code in separate files makes the web development a lot easier and more manageable. If we would write our server-side code in the HTML page, and later if we also write some client scripts here in HTML markup, our web form would get really complicated and long, requiring a lot of scrolling up and down to find a specific piece of code to do changes. In other words, if you have all code in single place, you would have an application that is hard to change and maintain. So one thing, what links the code behind file to our web form is this code behind attribute inside the page directive. Pay attention, if you provide a code behind file name that actually doesn't exist, you will receive an error. Two very common ways to access code behind file are, you can right click in an empty space in the web form and choose view code from this pop-up menu. Or alternatively, you can expand the Webform item in the Solution Explorer by clicking the small arrow to display the code behind file and then double click on the code behind file displayed. These two options will load the code behind file in the editor. So this is how the code behind file should look like initially. First, at the top, there will be a list of using statements that include some .NET namespaces or libraries. I generally keep them since I will probably need all or most of them later when writing my C# code. Under the using statements, you will see the namespace keyword. The namespace is an overarching component that helps you organize your program. By default, the web forms you add to your project will have the root namespace named with the project name, which is Intro to Web Forms in my case. After the namespace, there is this class definition line, which actually tells that our code behind file is a class file and it inherits from system.web.ui.page class, which is actually a .NET class. At this point, it is important to mention that in C#, everything is indeed a class, including the code behind files associated with your ASP.NET web forms. This is why C# is called an object-oriented language. And you may see the page load event. Page load event is automatically created for our own convenience since we will often need to have some code to perform some initial functionality, such as displaying some records when someone accesses our page. Soon we will write some code for the page load event. Before we do that, let's switch back to our default.aspx file by either double-clicking on it in the Solution Explorer or by right-clicking anywhere over the code behind code and choose Web Designer from the menu, which is my preference in general. Then you will see the page open in the design view. Also pay attention to the toolbox. All web controllers are automatically listed for our use. In this tutorial, we will use two controls, label and button. To add a control to the page, I can either double click on the control, which will add the control to where my cursor is, and my cursor was inside the div tag. Or you can drag and drop it to a specific location in your page. So please add a label control and next to it add a button control. Now we need to change some properties of the controls. First, choose the label. You will see the associated properties of the label are displayed in the properties window. I generally prefer to list the properties by alphabetical order. It makes it easier for me to locate some specific item. Every control inside the same web form should be given a unique ID. We will use ID of the web controls to access them in the code behind file. Also, don't forget that, similar to variable names, you can use only alphanumerical characters and underscore when defining an ID for any control. And also don't forget that ID cannot start with a number. I will write LBL underscore display for the ID of the label. This is a naming convention that I use all the time. If it is a label control, I start with LBL underscore and then a short descriptive name for the label. If it is a button, then I use btn underscore prefix. If it is a text box, I use txt underscore prefix. And it goes this way. I strongly recommend you to have this habit of naming the web controls with a specific naming convention consistently throughout your project. Soon you will see why this is very important when we start writing some code in the code behind file. Please scroll down in the property list and locate the text property. And please delete the existing value. This way, we make sure that the label will be initially empty, displaying nothing. Let's view our file in split view. As you may see, some lines of markup is added to our page. ASP colon label is for the label, and ASP colon button is for the button. You may see also the properties that we just changed for the label are added as attributes to the label tag. Actually, you can create the web controls in the HTML markup by directly typing them and changing their properties. I will change the properties of the button here. I will set an ID equals to btn underscore submit. I also want submit text appear in the button, so I will set its text property the submit. You may have already noticed that the button text is updated in the design view. Once you are done with changing the attributes of the button, please double click on the button control. Then the code behind file will be automatically opened with some new code. Actually, this new code is btn_submit_click_event_handler. That is, ASP.NET created a function, or commonly known as event handler, that will be executed whenever there is a click event on the button. Note that the naming convention that ASP.NET uses for the name of the event handler is id_of_the_button_click. This click event handler has two parameters. Sender with object type, this is the button just clicked, and also E with event args type. This parameter allows you to access some characteristics of the click event. If you go back and check the HTML markup of the button, you will see that submit click event handler is bound to onClickEvent here. If you have these attributes set to an event handler that actually doesn't exist in the code behind file, then you will receive an error. For example, if I change this to btn submit click 1 accidentally, then I will receive an error because there is no such event handler existing in the code behind file. So the point is that event handler names have to match in the designer and in the code behind file. Let's write some code in a click event to add some functionality. What I want to do in particular is, when the button is clicked, the text displayed in the label control should change. Writing the code for this functionality is actually pretty simple. We need to write only a single line of code. So the first question that I need to answer is, what control am I going to change something about? It is label, right? Because we want to change its text. Next, how do I access this specific label control? Of course, with its ID property. And I know that based on the naming convention that I use, its ID should start with lbl_prefix. So I will start typing lbl_ and there you go. Thanks to its IntelliSense feature, Visual Studio already gave me the option that I need, which is lbl_display, the ID of the label. What is next is, I need to assign some text to the label's text property. How do I access the properties of a control? Very simple. I just need to add a dot just after its ID. And again, thanks to IntelliSense feature of Visual Studio, I'm able to get the list of properties associated with the label control. I need to choose text from the list. Now I need to assign a value to this text property. How do I assign a value to the property? Of course, by using the assignment operator. And what is last is, I need to provide some text that I want to display with the label. I will just type someone clicked the button inside the quotation marks. Please also don't forget to add a semicolon at the end of the line. In C#, every single line of code needs to have a semicolon at the end. I also want to display some initial text in this label when someone accesses our page the first time. I will add almost the same piece of code to page.event, except that I will provide a slightly different text to display. Now we are ready to run our application and test it. Please run your project by clicking on the green run button on the toolbar. If you don't have this button here, you can display it by right-clicking just anywhere on the toolbar and then choosing standard. So this button will compile the project and switch to debugging mode and display the default ASPX in the chosen browser. If you prefer not to run with debugging, then you can press Ctrl F5 from your keyboard. Initially, the label displays page is loaded text as we expected. When we click the button, the label text changes to someone clicked the button, which means our code is working correctly. So I will go back to my code behind file to do some changes, and oops, I can't, because our application was run with debugging, and in the debugging mode, you cannot do changes in your code behind file. If you want to do changes, then you need to click this red square to stop the debugging. Before I end this video, I want to show one thing. You can add breakpoints in your code behind file if you want to pause your application at specific lines for testing. Let's say I want to add a breakpoint to this line of code inside the page load. So I expect that the application will pause at this breakpoint whenever the page load event is executed. To add a breakpoint, you need to place the cursor in the line where you want your program pause and press F9. Or you can also simply click on this gray area adjacent to the line. I will run the application with debugging enabled, and as I expect, the code stops when the page is loaded first time. Now I will add another breakpoint to this line inside the click event handler. Then I will click this to continue running the application. Now I will click on the button to see what happens. Surprisingly, the program pauses in the first breakpoint again, which means the page load event is executed again. However, I just click on the button which is supposed to call the click event handler, which means behind the scenes there's something going on. I will click continue, and now the program pauses inside the click event handler as I expected. However, why did the button click cause the program pause at the first breakpoint? Why the page load event is executed when I click the button? So this is a question that I will answer in another video, which is gonna be about postback and view state. Thanks for watching and happy coding!